In our last video, the DIY RE Trinity faced off a bunch of other stabilization systems in a side-by-side showdown. Today, however, we're going to be giving you guys a comprehensive overview to help you determine if this system is correct for you. Hey guys, Christian here. 大家好, Christian登来了. Before we begin, I do want to remind you guys that everything has been moved over to this new channel. So make sure you hit that subscribe button, and while you're at it, hit that bell button down below. Also, another reminder, the subtitles are going to be down here. It's going to say English, but it's actually a duo sub for English and Mandarin Chinese. Additionally, for all the camera gear that we're going to be explicitly talking about today, there will be affiliate links down below for American and Canadian Amazon. Without further ado, let's begin. So in our last video, we had that side-by-side showdown comparison between many different types of stabilization systems. So the first one being with camera just like that, walking around, trying to dampen your steps. That was number one. The second stabilization system included this UU rig top handle in conjunction with this small rig SLR cage. The third stabilization system was the Steadicam over here, the cheapest one I could find on Amazon, the newer carbon fiber Steadicam. The fourth stabilization system was using this motorized gimbal, and in my case, it's gonna be the G&Crane M2. And for the fifth and final stabilization system, that's gonna be our DIY RE Trinity. So that combines our Steadicam, as we mentioned before, in conjunction with our motorized gimbal. In combining them all, we were able to make this fantastical beast. If you haven't checked out that video, I do recommend you check it out. It's gonna be up here. I'm gonna put a card for you guys so you can click on that. And it's probably gonna influence your decisions the most if you consider making this thing for yourself. Instead, we're gonna be talking about how it works, when and why you would need a stabilization system like this, and some other important considerations and limitations. Now, before we begin, so we can have like a baseline control, I'm gonna tell you guys what gear we're running with today. At the bottom, we have our newer carbon fiber Steadicam. Our motorized gimbal today is gonna be the G&Crane M2. At the top, we're gonna have our Sony A7 III mirrorless full frame camera. I've already balanced this so we can get this boring stuff out of the way. And now let's turn on the gimbal. There we go. So first, we're gonna be talking about how this stabilization system actually works. If you've had any experience studying physics in the past, you're probably more knowledgeable than me in this regard. But if you haven't, don't worry, I'm going to try to explain this as simple as possible for both my sake and for your sake. So let's first start with a side shot of the DIY RE Trinity. In the field of physics, this is what they would call a class 1 lever. A class 1 lever is described by having its payload and effort on opposite sides to each other, with a fulcrum in the middle. In the center, we have our pivot point, the handle. In classical physics, this is called the fulcrum. Side A would be called the load. Side B would be called the effort. As we act upon the effort arm with the input force, the payload responds by moving in the opposite direction. So for example, if we were to push the effort arm up, the payload would move down. If we were to push the effort arm down, the payload would move up. Remembering back from our physics 101 classes in high school and university, we know that force times distance is equivalent to work. Subsequently, our class 1 lever system can be described by this formula. The force and distance of A is equivalent to the force and distance of B. Here, our forces are gravitational forces. This is the force of gravitational acceleration, or in layman's terms, gravity. And because our formula shows two sides of one whole, we know that our force and distances are relatively constrained. Now, in an ideal system, both the payload and effort would be at the same distance and same mass. Now, in our case, the DIY RE Trinity, although it is a class 1 lever, it is not an ideal system. What I mean by this is you'll notice that one of the arms is longer than the other. In this case, the effort arm is much longer. So, for example, let's say we were to increase the force of our payload. Let's add a step-up ring, let's add a filter flip mount, and an ND filter. Let's add a microphone. By increasing the weight of our payload, we've also increased the force of our payload. For our lever to remain balanced, we would either have to add extra weights to our Steadicam, or we would have to increase the length of the arm. Now, that only considers the class 1 lever in this axis. But because our Steadicam has a 3-axis gimbal, we can also move in this direction as well. But now that we've talked about the theoretical side, we can move on and talk about real-world application. In our observable universe, we live in 3-dimensional space. We have our x-axis, we have our y-axis, and we have our z-axis. Usually, the x-axis is denoted as the major plane of movement. Horizontal movement forward, and horizontal movement backward. Y-axis, on the other hand, is horizontally perpendicular. Movement left, and movement right. The z-axis is vertically perpendicular to both. We have movement upward and movement downward. Now, usually when we think about 3D space, we only consider these planar axes, x, y, and z. But where cameras and stabilizations are concerned, we also have rotational axes. So these rotational axes involve the angular rotational movement around our planar axes. So on our x-axis, we have a rotation rolling right and rolling left. Therefore, we call this the roll axis. On a y-axis, we have rotation tilting up and tilting down. Therefore, we call this the tilt axis. On our z-axis, we have rotation panning left and panning right. Therefore, we call this the pan axis. So in total, we have 6 axes to consider. We have 3 planal axes, x, y, and z, and we have 3 rotational axes, roll, tilt, and pan. The planal axes are controlled by us, the operator. We can move up, we can move down. We can walk forward, we can walk backward. We can walk left, we can walk right. We can also combine these for even more complex movements. Rotational axes are then stabilized entirely by the motorized gimbal. And in situations where we hold the motorized gimbal using a different grip, for example, switching from hammer grip to dagger grip, the pan axis motor now stabilizes the roll, and the roll axis motor now stabilizes the pan. Now this is why the DIY RE Trinity is important. Although we have our rotational axes stabilized, we also forget that there's room for human error. Usually while walking, our hips and knees move up and down. Our planal axes can lead to unforeseen vibrations, and this is sometimes noticeable in footage, even while we're using gimbals. While the framing and composition never changes, the perspective shifts from high to low to high to low every time we make a step. And people usually combat this by crouch walking and ninja walking. And that's where this guy comes in. The 3-axis Steadicam handle dampens and smoothens our control inputs. And although a class 1 lever rotates on a fulcrum, the actual distance of the payload from the fulcrum gives us the effective stabilization of the Z axis and the Y axis. Comprehensively, this gives us 5-axis stabilization. Y, Z, roll, tilt, and pan. Whereas a motorized gimbal by itself, or even a Steadicam by itself, would only be able to give us 3 axes of stabilization. And that's why this thing is so awesome. One of the main reasons why I love using this system is I don't really have to ninja walk as much as I used to. I can reduce the strain on my muscles, my tendons, my ligaments, and even my joints. It makes all of your dynamic camera movements so much easier. Now, after all is said and done, this thing isn't perfect. So now we're going to be moving to some of the considerations and limitations that I found while using the system. Now, of course, I'm not the first one who came up with this idea, using a Steadicam and a gimbal together. We have RE Trinity and we have some other YouTubers. Watching their videos, I've seen them use an overhand hammer grip. And this upper grip is really fatiguing, right over here on my forearm. For myself though, I prefer using an underhand hammer grip, underhand like this. And I haven't really seen any noticeable differences. If it does, and you know this, please do let me know. But I want to remind you guys, the whole reason why I use this DIY RE Trinity system is because I'm looking for comfort. I don't want to have to strain while making dynamic movements, when I orbit the subject, when I walk left to right, when I move forward. So I'm going to be using that underslung hammer grip. Now, the main considerations and limitations I have for the system, it's not really for the system itself. I mean, if you really wanted to, you could spend $50,000 on the real thing. But most people don't have that kind of money, so limitations, I would say one of them is your budget. Think about what you're willing to spend when investing in new gear. I've seen people use glide cams, I've seen people use fly cams, but those things are so expensive, they're like $500. I just went on Amazon. This Steadicam here, $79. I'm not saying it's perfect, but it works for me. Even the gimbal I'm using the most cost-effective motorized gimbal on the market right now, and that's the Geon Crane M2. It's only like, what, less than $300 US. It works well with smartphones, it works well with point-and-shoots, it works with this Sony a7 III, although with some restrictions, of course. Here are some of the downsides I found when using the Geon Crane M2. The first one is that the roll axis motor isn't actually entirely a true roll axis motor. It exists on an angle. It's kind of in between a roll axis and a pan axis. Although it's super smooth and responsive, it doesn't truly rotate around the x-axis. The second complaint is that the pan axis arm actually doesn't extend that far. So with my current setup, my pan axis actually isn't perfectly balanced. For a perfectly balanced motorized gimbal, while tilting it to the side, the pan axis is not supposed to swivel at all. In my case, if I'm using the a7 III, which is a bigger payload, and with the lens, it's kind of a longer payload as well, the pan axis just swivels. It has these micro jitters on the roll axis, back and forth, back and forth. My third complaint is that while balancing for the tilt axis, the Sony a7 III is just too tall. Every time you tilt back, the viewfinder just hits the roll axis motor. Simply put, there isn't enough clearance. As a result, I have to put the Sony a7 III lower on the tilt axis arm. This gives it clearance at the cost of not being perfectly balanced. Now, my suggestion in avoiding all these problems is get a bigger motorized gimbal. Get a Geon Weeble S. Get a Geon Crane. Or, oh, there's one coming out right now, the Crane 2S. You could change the arm for the roll axis. So right now we have an angled roll axis on this little guy over here, but on the Crane 2S, you can actually switch this little arm. You can go for an arm that's like this, and it's actually perfectly vertical. But yeah, get a Geon Weeble S, get a Geon Crane, get a DJI Ronin, get a motorized gimbal that can support and balance your payload. Again, the limitations exist within your budget. I'm the second coming of Jesus Christ.
prove it.
Turn that poop into wine. Turn that poop into wine.
For me, I just avoid using the Sony A7 III for my RE Trinity system. I've honestly found better results with my Sony ZV-1 point-and-shoot camera. So usually when I'm doing the DIY RE Trinity, I'll use the ZV-1. But if I'm just using the motorized gimbal by itself, I would use Sony A7 III. When I use the ZV-1 for this whole stabilization system, I get no problems at all. It's absolutely amazing. And that's with active stabilization off. I'm just using standard IBIS or just no IBIS at all. Now, if you don't take my word for it and you still want to use the Sony A7 III on the Crane M2, here are the four lenses I would recommend. From my own experience, I've only been able to test two of them, and both of them are official Sony lenses. So we have the Sony APS-C series kit lens. This is the SELP1650. It's only about 30 millimeters, 1.2 inches in length. So it's a pancake lens. It's got OSS, which is optical steady shot. That's your lens stabilization. It's got power zoom. I think it's the only Sony lens that has power zoom. I'm not entirely sure. And it basically means that the zooming functionality has an electronic motor assist. The other lens I would recommend and have actually tested is this SEL5018F. This is another official Sony lens, full frame this time. It's at a 50 mil focal length with an f1.8 aperture. Although this lens is double the length, coming at around 60 millimeters, they're honestly very, very similar in weight. The fabrication uses composite plastic materials, so it's actually really, really light. One lens that I'm hopeful into trying is the SEL35F18F, which is basically just a wider version of this lens. Though I'm not entirely sure if that one is fabricated using composite plastics. So as for non-Sony lenses, there is one that people do recommend, and that is the Samyang 24mm f2.8 full-frame pancake lens with autofocus. It has a very similar size and framing composition to this APS-C lens over here, but it comes with the added bonus of being full-frame and having a wider aperture. Again, I'm gonna leave some affiliate links for you guys down in the description down below. There will be some American affiliate links and there will also be some Canadian. So yeah, just check the description down below. It's on a kit.co link and it's very, very organized. It's at no extra cost to you guys, but it helps motivate me and keep this channel alive.
Okay, so I think it's time now that we move on to the comments from last video. So SheLuluLu Music says, "This video should go viral." Thank you very much. That's actually very kind of you to say. I'm just making content that I'm passionate about. She continues on by saying, "What gear would you recommend for filming, snowboarding, and diving?" 或是和潜水用什么设备合适? But I'll give you guys a literal translation. Skiing, snowboarding, and diving. Using what kind of equipment is most suitable? Now, I'm glad you asked that question, SheLuluLu. The short answer is, I would probably not recommend a DIY RE Trinity system for action sports like these. I would in fact recommend using a GoPro on a selfie stick or maybe even an Insta360 or 360 camera. The reason why is because this is a little bit bigger, it's a little bit unwieldy, and it could be dangerous when you're using this for an action sport. That being said, if you have another operator who can help you out, maybe they are following you while you take the lead, it would be a bit safer. Also, I've had this experience in the past. I'm not entirely sure if it applies to bigger gimbals like Jiun Crane M2, and actual like, you know, SLR gimbals and stuff like that. But in the case of my first gimbal, which was the Jiun Smooth Q for mobile phones, I actually noticed a problem where when I was on a bus, and I noticed that while we were in motion, my camera kept tilting up just like that every time we were going uphill. So I'm not sure if inertia and momentum will play a role into gimbals like this. So honestly, I would say probably just stick to a GoPro for now. You're less likely to run into problems concerning inertia, as well as problems that might jeopardize your safety. So yeah, good question. If anyone else has any curiosities out there concerning this stabilization system, please do let me know. Leave a comment down below. I also have a Discord, so feel free to drop into the server as well.
Anyways, I digress. So that's gonna be it for today. I'm not sure if we're gonna continue this series with the DIY RE Trinity. These three episodes that we've already released might be it. So the first video was just a general introduction. We did the small B-roll at Cathedral Town with a motorcycle. The second video was a stabilization test where we compared different stabilizations together and we had a showdown side by side. You can see all the footage together. We had five at a time and we also did two at a time, kind of like that. As for this last video, it was a comprehensive overview on how it works, when and why you would need it, and what kind of considerations and limitations you might need to think about if you're planning on making this for yourself. So yeah, that's gonna be it for today, guys. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button down below and smash that bell button while you're at it. We have a lot more content coming up, not just with camera stuff. We're gonna be doing motorcycle stuff in the future as well. So yeah, definitely stay tuned. I try to post every weekend, usually on Sundays, so you sure as heck wouldn't wanna miss it. See you guys in the next video. Peace. All right, let's turn this bad boy on. So first the camera. I've already balanced this. Where did the accent come from? I've already balanced this, so you don't have to worry.